So, could you kindly tell us what the date is today, Mark?
Oh, so anyway, the women went a little bit too late.
My watch says Monday the 12th, but I think...
14th.
Okay, it's Pesach, right, babe?
It's Pesach. It's April.
All right, here's my watch.
It's the 20th, maybe, 21st.
My watch? I can't read my watch.
Lee
Diamond.
Ali was really smart. Why? He got off at the bus
and went
all
that way.
Oh,
hi.
How are you doing?
Wait,
my wife Jackie. Last year when we left you guys at midnight, it took us 2.5 hours to get home.
What?
Hi. Listen, it's Pesach, and we just couldn't figure out what year it is. What year is it?
I don't know.
Hi. How
are
you?
Hi.
Hi.
How
you doing?
Hi, how you doing?
Hello.
All right. Leah, it's really, I feel at a slight disadvantage.
Younger brother?
Thank you.
I mean, very mature right now, man. Do you want to say anything to the crowd who might be seeing this later, perhaps in America? Like, for example, do you want to say hello to Ben?
Hi, Gabby. Hi, Ben.
Ben.
How are you guys?
Grandma.
Oh, I don't remember that.
Grandma, Grandpa. Oh, no, not too close. All right. Well, from who?
I'm reading.
Judy.
I'm reading. Are you listening?
Tell us what it is.
Hello, everyone. It is late on Sunday afternoon. We just returned from the weekend at Camp Eisner for our annual temple Shabbaton. Everyone see how good I read.
Who's this from?
I don't know. It was great.
You don't know.
From Aunt Debbie. It was great, as always. Jay and his friend, Barack, came with us, and they had fun, even though there were only 4 or 5 kids their age.
Is there anything interesting you could read?
I'm looking for interesting stuff. It's relaxing. I spent a bunch of time in another part of the camp just researching my Baruch paper.
Okay, we're cutting. Sorry, Leon.
There you go.
Sorry, you got to find something interesting. Music.
We had a nice
Hey, Jerry. Do you want to say... Do you want to say hello? Jerry, can you say Pesach Sameach? Oh, very good. Jerry, are you and Orly going to sing a song tonight?
Yeah.
Which song? Jerry, which song, Jerry? Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, you are Asaf? Oh, not bad. That was like a total guess. And, okay, well, this is just a regular video.
Lipstick, show your fingers.
Let's see.
The nail polish.
Let's see the nail polish.
Perfume. And the necklace.
Well,
you're
very...
You're a glamour girl.
Come on.
Go. All right, very nice.
It's
for Shira.
David?
Yeah.
And Tell us more.
What's
that?
The hole.
Hey, Orly, no.
A run in the stocking. Okay, so, Tamar. Boy. Okay. Tatlilanu, Vakasha. Mama Tzav, Politica, Ma'av, Vakasha.
Ma. Ma.
אולי מישהו אחר רוצה לדבר על המצב?
אני לא חושבת שאף אחד רוצה לדבר על המצב עכשיו.
אוקיי, משהו אחר. מה קורה עם הגבר שלך?
הוא לא כאן.
מה?
הוא לא כאן.
הוא לא כאן. כמה שעות?
5 שבועות וחצי.
5 שבועות וחצי ושניות.
אוקיי, גאיז,
אוקיי. Beginning of the Seder, right?
But I put my mom. This is before the Seder.
Thank you.
Rega, we're all sitting down.
Yes.
This is Jerry's bib. Now watch how I put it on.
Who are we waiting for?
Okay, waiting for us.
Who are we waiting for?
Judy, he's moving his truck.
Huh?
Yeah.
moving his truck.
David, any pre Seder comments?
Oh, do we have an extra chair? Oh, Michael.
Yes.
Okay.
I am going to put this down.
There's a seat for me. You have a seat.
Any comments before I turn this thing off?
Michael, we would like to invite you to join us, Michael.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not getting ready for the evening.
I watched
Langer Bueller. Oh, I know what it is.
This is like, why do you go to Mikvah?
It's becoming cold.
If you went to Mikvah. So this is a
just kind of a ritual of purity, getting ready to act.
This is like taking your shoes off before you get in.
But I think there's another reason. Everything has to be different in order to arouse interest.
So we normally wash once.
We have to dip twice to arouse interest.
That's true.
No, but why? Why the middle one? I don't know why, by the way. Why the middle one?
It doesn't get enough attention.
Because it's very nice.
That's very
nice. No, first of all, hold it.
How many
halot do we usually use on a holiday?
Two.
And why do we use two?
Why are there two halot?
Because two
people
are
married. What? No, Bali show, that's not bad.
Halot, we get two because
stick together.
Because of Haman.
That's right. Because of Haman.
What do you mean because of Haman?
What are they going to do with this? Haman. Oh, that, I see. So therefore, we have an extra one meantime, right? Yeah. And
wait a minute. So why do we have Korean Pesha? I understand why we have, because of the man, we have two on Shabbat. But why do we have three Matzot on Pesha?
I think the answer is the same answer that we gave before. It's a different.
This is supposed to be an event which is different than any other event, and that arouses the curiosity.
Maybe the Kohanim have one, the Levim have one, and I'm sure.
Yeah, by the way, they should. The three halot, the representative of the three divisions of Israel.
Kohen,
Kohen
Levim. Meaning the Kohanim can.
I like the idea of the Kohanim because if we ever build a third temple, Bruce Cohen would be the high priest and the chief rabbi would have to stand outside.
I would
come up
with him.
No, Jerry,
I want you to see this. Jerry, in a little while, you're going to have to find this. It's going to be hidden, Jerry. And with Orly's help, you're going to find this. And when you find it, at the certain point that we tell you to, if you don't find it, we can't finish the Seder, which means we can't get the chocolate mousse for dessert. So therefore, it's very important. So at some point, I'll hide it. She understands perfectly.
The Afikoman.
It's called the Afikoman.
It's what's inside.
And what's inside is half a matzah. You see? You see anything in front of this? Anything behind this?
Oh, no.
Yeah, you're not supposed to.
Jay, when we find the Afikoman, do we get presents?
Now, when you have to ask the question, why do we break the matzah? The matzah in the middle, Lee took out and broke it. And half of it is going to be the Afikoman. But why break it? What does that represent? I asked the kids in school. Let's see if you guys come up with better answers.
She's looking for it.
Jerry, it's a little early. She's going in the refrigerator.
Jerry's looking.
She's looking now. The question is, why break the matzah? What's the matter?
I'm fairly convinced that some of the work that we do in different areas may not change a lot. I at least want to look my kids in the face and say, I wasn't part of the problem. I did my best. I tried. But I made my effort. And if things are going wrong.
As a Jew or as a person?
What?
As a Jew or as a person?
As an individual here in the Jewish state, as a Jew, I would like to
hear. Some of the kids don't understand.
Some of them may not understand. be some point that I could say, okay, I mean, you know, this goes back to when Tamara was when she wore that T-shirt, remember? When Tamara wore that T-shirt, Freedom of the Press, and she was attacked by, you know, all these people saying you're a traitor, whatever they said. And when she came back and she said that she now knows that it must feel like being Arab. And at that point, the Intifada was on for about a year, and I had done very much. And I felt, you know, at least so I can say that, you know, her or my other children, I tried, I did something. Fully aware that the changes that we could bring about are so limited. So limited. Do it for your own self and self respect.
Maybe this is really all about. And she happened? No. Well,
Go away. Poor Jim. What happened to Jim's butt? No, no. Hey, everyone likes to do that. Judith. So, this may be shown in America, so I'm wondering if you'd like to comment on the latest news in the States about
the news in the States.
You know, Bethesda, Maryland.
Oh, Bethesda, Maryland. Well, since I'm in the kitchen, I guess we're all going to miss that gas range thing. What is it, that cookout thing that you cook in?
Oh, yeah, we used to. Well, after I became a vegetarian, it wasn't much use, but.
Yeah?
Yeah, what else are you going to miss about the old house?
The forest. Just saying, hi, yes, my parents have a mansion in Bethesda, you know, but the house itself, not really.
What about, what about the dumb waiter?
Dumb waiter. We got a lot of dumb waiters here.
Yeah, right.
Dumb waiter.
What about
a
the...
Dumb waiter is a special...
What about the automatic waterfall?
I want to have their ice machine.
What about the cool...
The ice machine, right?
What about the connection in the closet in my old room?
Yeah, well, you used to do that, Mike. I didn't climb...
You never got into that.
Not like...
All right.
Sorry.
What about...
Yes?
All right, I guess I...
Catch me later.
I guess I have all the experience.
Where are they going to put all the furniture?
What are you reading, Mike?
I looked him, but there's nothing
more. Show what's new in current events, Mark. Front page. Front page.
Yeah, but there's nothing more.
Okay, Nixon. Not indicted. No indictment.
I don't like Debbie's language. Look what she writes. I have a shitload of stuff.
Who wrote that?
Debbie Perlmutter.
That's a rabbi's wife?
A shitload of stuff. Look,
Daddy, look, Daddy, look, Daddy, look, Daddy, look, Daddy, look, Daddy,
look, Daddy, look, Daddy, look, Daddy, look, Daddy, look, Daddy, look, Daddy,
look, Daddy, look, can we talk English just for the camera?
Why?
Well, let's just say that the people in the States won't understand.
Why are you showing it to people in the States? I don't want people in the States.
Nobody knows.
This is going to be sent first to Debbie and Mayor and Gabby and Ben and Jonathan. Why? Because... Oh, wow. Okay, Jared, tell us who's the best rock and roll group in Israel. Who?
Machina, but they broke a
little bit. Oh, Machina, you mean
Machina
or...
Sorry?
Now isn't the guy from Chaverim Shel Natasha? What's his name again? Isn't he gay?
No.
Yes, he is. By the way.
Oh, sorry.
There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that. So is Elton John? That's very good there.
So is a friend of mine.
And Leon, have you gotten any more...
Look at the mouth.
Have you gotten any more liberal on your views about homosexuality?
No.
I'm in love with a girl.
Okay.
In love with
called Gabby.
Oh, Gabby.
Yes, very much.
Leon, how old are you now? 22? Whoa, getting up there, I see. Okay, if I run. If I run.
His house.
His house? Poor guy, couldn't come to the family.
Thank goodness.
Yeah. Shira, okay, let's go to you now.
Wait, I want to ask Gabby, how is Jason?
Which one is he?
And how is, I forgot her name, Lisa, I think? Sarah.
Oh, she's still with Chad?
And he broke up with
Jay.
Her. Who's Jay with?
I don't know.
Get that Jay said every day you're with somebody else.
He wishes.
Okay, now tell me about the army. When's that coming out?
I got a
talk in English.
my first call for the Army.
You did?
Yes, I did. Maybe I didn't tell you.
No, you didn't. You got your first call to the Army, and?
And for the first of, for the 9th of July.
9th of July?
Yes, I've had Brazil.
And then you'll go where?
She'll go shoot at Arabs. I'll go shoot. That's what she'll do.
Is that true?
Yes, it's going to kill all the Arabs. All the Arabs.
David.
Yeah.
Where are you? Could you come here for a moment?
No, don't tell what I said.
I asked your daughter Shira what she was going to do in the Army.
So what? Wait, so what should I give you?
David? What?
So we'll make it interesting. I'll say that I hate American.
Oh, Jenny, you want dessert?
Right, we'll make it interesting. David?
Jenny, Foreman, you want dessert?
I asked your daughter what she was going to do in the Army.
Which one? Shira?
The one that is going to the Army.
And?
She said.
She's going to do her underwear.
She's going to kill all the Arabs.
Not even funny, guys.
And then we'll have peace on land. We won't have any problems.
She was being hubris.
No, just kidding.
Just kidding.
Okay.
She's going to kill all the righties.
The world is divided in such a way that... What did you say? The leftists and the murderers.
Whoa,
very interesting, yeah.
That's my dad's view.
A philosopher.
My brother,
remember?
Not really.
Quasi-war.
Abba, do you know what it is?
That's a quasi-war. Wiggly-poo.
No.
Yeah, moving in the right direction. Going in the political direction that Abba would want you to.
Jerry, go look for the Afikoma. You have to go find it.
Go
help Orly. Go help Orly find it.
No. Getting warmer. Getting warmer, my right Jerry. Orly, come, Jerry, come with Orly.
Help me find it.
Maybe it has something to do with things that you would read.
Oh.
Computer.
Maybe.
Yes, because. Time has passed, and we have our... Hey, Daddy-o. Listen, Dennis.
I had a missed pacer, but I'm so glad to see you all here on Shabbat. Shabbat in Yerushalayim.
Cool. So, Dad, listen, oh, we got to get a picture of Iran and Liat leaving.
Iran, Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat
Shalom. Mazal Tov al Mita.
Liat,
very lovely. Very maturely, huh?
Lean at the set. Tel Aviv?
No,
that's good.
On Ashton. It's a weekly small, I mean.
Come on, man.
Can you give her a kiss?
Give me a kiss?
Bye, Aldi.
Bye, everybody.
Right. Video with the video camera.
Okay, come on. You should have complimented you earlier. You would have some, you know.
You got
women in lingerie.
Whoa.
A backwards? I think it's on
the side. Look at this.
I don't know which
one. What's going on?
I like the colors of that one, but this one's cool. Tell us to go.
What's going on here, Mom?
We're just choosing gifts.
Videotape. I've been meaning to do this for quite a while. I don't know. We may have a follow-up session later on, but on the Yom HaTzmaut or something like that. How you feel, man?
Well, it serves me right. A few years ago, you know, I wrote this book, The God I Believe In, based on interviews with 14 different intellectuals, rabbis, scholars, scientists, and I was in your chair asking them questions. Now I guess it's my turn to answer questions. I'm ready. You tell me what you want to know.
I don't know if that they will be on the spiritual level that of the questions that you were asking.
I'll answer the questions provided you promise not to write a book about it.
Okay, got a deal. So I ask you, how are you feeling?
I feel good. As far as I know, I am doing well. I'm feeling fine. I exercise regularly. I pray every day. I eat well. I sleep well. We are starting a new chapter in our life as we are moving from our house to an apartment.
Yes. So you're soon going to be selling the house. That is.
It's sold. It has been sold.
How do you feel about the move?
Nostalgic in a way, because going over boxes and cartons of letters and papers and pictures and whatnot. Our whole life seems to turn into a reel, and we see different scenes, different moments. We went through the records of the three weddings that we had at our home, and it's a time when we're grateful for the many good things we enjoyed, and we know that life cannot be lived over again, so we look to the future with good feelings. We had a good life so far in the place we stayed at for 30 years almost, 29 years, and now we're looking forward to the years to come.
So, you moved to D.C. when?
We got to Washington in 1969. years later, I retired from the pulpit.
What would have happened? Can you imagine not having moved to the Washington area?
Yes, I can imagine very well, because we were very happy in Clinton for 18 years. We lived there and worked and had many friends and a lot of gratification. However, my congregation, you may know that, did not want to make the major step that would have enabled me to work happily for the rest of my life in Trenton. They didn't want to go out and build a new synagogue building with school, because the building in which we were was antiquated, and I felt that I was getting less and less returns for double efforts. We were working uphill against many obstacles to maintain the congregation, and so I decided then that it was time to go. And I so told the congregation, gave them 1 year in which to change their mind, and since nothing happened in that course of the year, providentially the call came from Washington who wanted me. So we moved to Washington. It was very exciting. In many ways, though, my life became very much more preoccupied with the synagogue, with the community. I was terribly busy, less and less private time. And so when I saw a chance to retire, I was very happy, glad of it, and I retired perhaps a few years earlier than I would have had I been in a different city.
What was it like when you moved, in your first few years, when you moved to D.C. or Maryland?
Oh, it was a time of enormous excitement. Those were the late 60s, early 70s, politically. Washington was a hotbed. The Nixon administration was going down the drain in the Watergate scandal, and I was trying very hard to build a united Jewish community. My own congregation fortunately grew very rapidly, and still I was able to stay with the family a lot of time. I was able to spend with the family. We went on vacations still 2 months during the summer. Went on trips. I tried as much as I could to have a private life in addition to the public life. I must say it got more and more difficult as the years went on.
Is there something specific that you can remember in when you first came to D.C. in terms of your job that was perhaps the most challenging parts of that job?
Well, the most challenging part of the job was to turn the congregation from a classic Reformed congregation that had gone practically the way of the Protestant church into a Jewish congregation that would unite with the rest of the community, to Judaize the congregation. For many of the people in the Washington Legal congregation, I was too Jewish. I remember that when we first got to Washington, Mrs. Kirstenfeld, the wife of the former rabbi, told me with tremendous joy that she had arranged places for you, Mike, and Danny to be accepted at the St. School, very prestigious and very
So, where were we? Let's
I was telling you that Mrs. Kirstenfeld had arranged for you two, for Danny and you, to go to St. Albans Day School, which was very prestigious, very Protestant. And I shocked her out of her wits when I said, "Never mind, we thank you for your effort, but the boys are going to the Jewish community day school."
Right. Now, as far as the day school was concerned, you were, isn't it true, though, that when we, you weren't initially, when you were in Trenton, for the day school scene, something happened which caused you to be completely in favor of it. Isn't that right?
In my last 2 years in Trenton, I became a strong supporter of the day school, and it started with an elderly Orthodox rabbi who came to see me, and he, in a way, humiliated himself, he humbled himself, asking me, the Reform rabbi, to help raise funds for the day school, which was going to go bankrupt. I promised I would do so, and I persuaded the Jewish Community Council of the Federation at that time to make an allocation to his day school, which was quite unprecedented. And in a way, I take credit for saving that day school.
But wait a minute. Now we went to the Trenton Hebrew Academy, or actually before that.
That was the school.
That was the Herzl and Zion, actually,
and
first.
And subsequently, I enrolled you and Danny in that school, and that really impressed the traditionally oriented Jews of Trenton very much. They were amazed that I would do that.
But what's interesting for me is the transition point for certain subjects, or where you changed kind of your way of thinking, be it the day school, going to the day school, or going to Israel. Were you always, for example, in favor of living in Israel?
I was always a Zionist. I was a Zionist in a way before I was really a Jew, or before I was religious. And this Zionism became ever more deeply embedded in my total outlook on Judaism. And so Mom and I made almost yearly trips to Israel. And as you know, when I had a year sabbatical, we took the whole family and we stayed in Israel for almost an entire year. I think that was a fundamental turning point. And later on, I felt that in a way, the Reform movement was weak in building life-sustaining Jewish convictions, that you needed to have a much stronger system of education. And that's why I turned into a supporter of the day school. I saw the results, and I'm
good.
Really, it's not for this little baby, but maybe about 6, 7, 8 years from now.
What did you learn in school today, dear little boy of mine? What did you learn in school today, dear little boy of mine? I learned that Washington never told a lie. I learned that soldiers seldom die. I learned that everybody's free. And that's what the teacher said to me. That's what I learned in school today. That's what I learned in school.
All right. Let me ask you something else, Dad. If you were my age today, or let's say about 10 years younger, if you were making a decision as to where you were going to live, and this is irrespective of where you had gotten a job offer, say, and you were starting off, say, age 20 years old, just 22, say, just gotten out of college, would you live in the States or in Israel? I assume those would be the two options.
For me as a rabbi...
Now.
For me as a rabbi, there was no option there. As a Reform rabbi in Israel, I doubt that I would personally want to be. But if I were in your shoes, an attorney, at the age of 35 or 40, thereabouts, with wife and young child, I think that you could probably financially, in the long run, do better in the United States. But given your opportunities here, which are pretty good, I think you can do very well in Israel too. But in addition to the financial aspect, I think perhaps more decisive is the chance of your happiness and satisfaction. I think it could be greater in Israel.
Let me interrupt you if I can. What I'm asking you, really getting at now, is more of a hypothetical situation, and not so much advice, but more of a question of, if you can kind of start your life, put yourself in the same exact situation that you were in. You just got married. Well, you were about 25, weren't you, when you got married? And you just got out of HUC. It's 1997. You recently married. Where would you live today?
If I had to pursue my chosen career as a rabbi, I would not want to be a Reform rabbi in Israel. There's no question in my mind. The Reform rabbinate, the training that I had was especially and almost exclusively suited for life in America, or in a country comparable to America. England, Australia would be possible. Canada would be possibility. But the life of a Reform rabbi in Israel, to my mind, the movement being what it is a prescription for heartbreak and frustration.
We're exception of the work that the son
All right, I'll say, with the sole exception of those Reform rabbis who are really not serving congregations but doing other important work, such as David, handling a very significant part of Jewish life in Israel.
And Levi Keller.
If you were living, if you had to choose, and I know it's a difficult question, let's say you had to choose between living 100% of your time in one country or another. It's not a nice choice, given you the fact that you have family. But let's just say that, aside from choosing to be with with family, where would you live, Israel or the United States? Right now, 1997, you.
For a professional person,
just a lawyer
or rabbi or myself, 100% of my time in any one country is unthinkable. Not in this century, not in our civilization. But I, for one, would now be ready to spend most of my time in Israel. Mom, as you know, feels a little different. She would like to sort of divide the time, probably with the preponderant amount of time still in the United States. I would not hesitate at all to reverse it and spend most of my time in Israel.
Why?
The interest of the family, the love of the family, but I can't ignore the fact that Debbie and Mayor and her children are in the United States, so I would miss them very much if I were here most of the time. But then also, to my mind, Israel is the country in which I feel most at home. And because I'm a Jew, and I'm an Israeli. We made Aliyah. We went a long way to the establishment of our own life in Israel, and I'm ready to spend more of my lifetime here.
What's the reason you... you didn't make Aliyah earlier in life? That is not, I mean, as you have done, couldn't you have done as a younger person exactly what you've done today?
No. You see, now I am not professionally dependent upon life in Israel as a Reform rabbi. I come here as a person independent, financially able to maintain itself. I do not have to work for a salary in the Reform rabbi. And I was not trained to do anything else in a different profession.
Well, transitions here.
It's not exactly what you had of it.
Reminds you of the old days.
Old lady, Statue of Liberty, first thing I saw when I
Hallelujah.
Came to the United States. Remember the ship moving into the harbor of New York, and there was the lady standing.
And would you have rather gone to Israel, perhaps?
Not at that time.
time I wanted to. Okay, dude.
So.
Okay. Why, what are you doing?
Oh, you are taking me anywhere. I gotta get ready for this.
Well, they might, they always go silent, they don't used to yet.
Dave, I'm doing it right now.
American music, right?
You're doing it now before?
Exactly.
Powder my nose.
Well, that would be natural. But can you show us how a woman should powder her nose?
I should. See? Now I want nose sunshine.
Mom?
Yes.
Let me ask you a serious question here, Mom. Honest.
You correct the day that Michael was born.
This is a total, you have to answer this completely honestly.
Okay.
Go ahead, this is a question about your relationship with Dad, okay?
Yes.
Compared to your
boyfriend?
No.
Okay, go ahead.
Your first year of marriage.
Yes.
And your this past year with Dad. Compared to which of these 2 years was Dad? Were you more attracted to Dad?
Attracted to him?
Physically.
Now, of course, now.
This is a little racy, Michael.
All right.
Michael.
Stupid question.
It started out well. Not stupid at all.
No.
Very attracted to him. All through the years, but it gets better and better. If it's good from the start, it gets better and better.
So. Mom, you don't have to say it. We're acting as if that's just part of the video. Okay, Mom. So, when you went out with Dad for the first time, how old were you?
16 and a half.
That's when you first went out on a date?
February 14th, Valentine's Day.
And was Dad allowed to cross the state boundary line with you?
We didn't go across the state boundary. Yes, we did, as a matter of fact. Not on our first day, but later we went to DeVue Park in Kentucky during the day on picnic.
At what age?
Rowboat. 16 and a half. I was about 17.
Shira's age, in other words.
17, yeah.
Didn't they have the Mann Act in effect at that time? That was the law which prohibited the crossing of state lines with a minor?
No, I don't believe so. Kentucky was the same city, practically, right across it.
Uh-huh.
You gotta tell Mike how you fooled me about your age.
Oh, I fooled you about my age. I really didn't. I just broke into a party of college students. My friend and I decided we would crash it. We dressed up in high heels. We were juniors in high school. And my sister Ruth was president of the college youth group at Isaac M. Weiss Temple. So we went to this, wasn't a dance, it was a meeting. And there I met this charming, handsome, dashing young rabbinical student. And he didn't know who I was, but he got someone to introduce us. And the following week he called me to go to a Rockdale Temple dance, but I was already busy.
Were you looking to meet a rabbi?
Sure, why not?
Well,
tonight
did
was full of them.
Were they full of themselves? All right. Well, so were any of your friends going out with Reform rabbis or anything?
Yes, no. But afterward, I introduced my dearest friend to Gibby, to his close friend, Mrs. Weidenhandler, and they became a couple too.
Okay. Yeah, sure.
Sure, come in.
Tamara, let me ask you a question while you're here.
Yeah.
I'm not
where,
so sure.
Who is your boyfriend? Is he also going to HUC?
Not
so
long.
Yes, he is now.
Is he currently enrolled in HUC?
Yes.
Okay.
Third generation.
Judy. Hi. Jenny, why did you why did you want to go out with somebody who also went to HUC?
Why did I
want to
go out with somebody from HUC?
Yeah.
I felt that I should be with a holy man. I felt that I would have a better chance of getting to heaven that way.
Okay, thank you.
And besides that, he had a sexy bod.
Okay.
Oh, my.
Great.
What did you say?
Yeah. Besides that, he had a sexy bod.
Tamara. Where'd she go? Oh, she ran away.
Yeah, Debbie should be here because she, after her sister got married, she said, I want to do just like my mom did. I want to marry a rabbi too. So she did. 2 weeks later, she met him in Cincinnati.
Now, did you ever dance to this song, Mom?
Not to that one, no.
It's a bit, You guys want to, you want to do a little dance here?
No.
In the mood to dance? Oh, okay, negative. Well, it's just the old times. Grown, come on. Your own style. Oh, that's not the way they danced in the old days.
Ooh, ooh, ooh.
Question, Orly.
Yes.
How old are you?
Ten.
You're 10?
Yes. I'm not 10.
Do you ever think about marriage? Is that how you... That okay.
Yes.
Tell me, when are
you... Who's you going to marry?
Abba.
You're going to marry Abba?
Yes.
No way.
Do you know that there are laws against that?
No.
All right.
No.
Let me ask something else. Orly, when is your bat mitzvah?
I have 2 years.
2 years?
Yeah.
Jerry, when is your bat mitzvah? In 10 years? Can you say 10 years?
No.
Can you say 10 years?
No.
Okay. All right. Orly, when you grow up, do you want to marry a rabbi?
No.
Okay.
No.
No, you don't either? Okay.
No.
Jerry, do you want to marry a rabbi?
No.
Okay.
Jerry, do you want to marry a lawyer?
You want to marry a lawyer?
A hot shot lawyer.
What I would like to be when I grow up is a gourmet chef. And I'm getting my start right here in my own backyard.
What day is it, Dave?
Today, it's Yom Ha'atzmaut, Israel's 49th birthday. I'm 4 years older than that. Danny is 8 years younger than that. And Michael, the baby of the family, soon will get there as he's still in his late 30s.
Could you show us one of those burgers that you're...
Better than that, I'll show you one of the hot dogs.
Nice, Dave. Oh, my God, that is... God. Good one.
Pretty good, huh? You want to see one of these great ones? Watch this.
This trick. Hi.
I've known him for a long time. Get my drone.
Stop.
Has my dad
Your dad has always been very entertaining, and we understand his sense of humor and appreciate it, but we don't take it too seriously.
Well, let me follow up on that, if I may.
Okay.
When you first met David Foreman, what was that? Well, no, can you just describe the first meal that you had with David Foreman?
Well, when I first met David, I was very suspicious. And so I had it checked out and thoroughly researched. And I was reassured that he was okay.
You know the name?
Was that, we won't get into that at this very moment, although that's an interesting story.
His eating habits were formidable.
Well, formidable.
Formidable, that's right. He had,
that's how we got his name.
Very healthy, very healthy appetite.
Well, let me ask you this. Did he ever burp at the table in front of you?
I think he did to impress Judy.
Thank you.
Well, that room is the border of the time.
Right, that's exactly where they are.
The
border, I think.
That is okay.
He's joking about their houses, the passage of the time and houses of the time. So that's exactly where they are.
Unique personality.
Like, you know, how far is that?
It's on, okay.
So is it on?
Yeah.
How do you know?
You'll see the red button in the middle is on. All right, don't worry about it.
Is it?
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
So, when I first met David Forman, I was very impressed. Because as a 10-year-old, he really impressed me as the kind of person I could relate to. You want to ask me any questions?
I'm concentrating on this camera.
Dad, you want to interview?
Yes. And what did you like best about it?
Well, I liked actually the fact that he would come up with some very funny statements, like cock-a-doodle pussy fart.
Uh-huh.
That impressed me the most.
I can't move, Orly.
Yeah.
What did you find particularly amusing about it?
That's enough.
Okay, I have a question. I have a question.
I have a question about his music. Weren't you impressed by his enormous knowledge of music and his capacity to play different instruments?
I was, actually. I liked it when Judy and David played, the Russian caravan, Russian Jewry caravan music, which I saw a couple of times.
Can we hear an example?
They were good. They were real good.
Can we hear an example?
That kind of thing.
Can I ask you another question, Uncle Mike?
Get out of here.
Uncle Mike, I want to ask you.
Yeah.
What in your personality today do you owe to my dad's influence on you?
Uh-huh. What in my personality? What?
Personality. What in your personality?
Oh, personality.
Can you owe to my dad's influence on you?
Maybe another reason.
I think I'd have to see a shrink on that one.
Maybe another factor.
Given the way it turned out, it's hopefully nothing.
Maybe another factor toward Aliyah.
Yeah.
Maybe. But, that in combo with, the rest of, the family being here made it a lot easier. But let's not turn this on to me. We're talking about Dave Forman here. What else? Okay, he did mess up. These are the kind of things that I related to as a 10-year-old. He totally blew the ping pong game, okay? The famous ping pong game. That really,
I want to make a point.
You have to move out because I can't get you in.
I want to make a point tomorrow. True, the last point I blew. But we would never have been in that situation if Michael hadn't previously blown so many points.
No, first of all, it's absolutely...
Those are the facts. And I'm a rabbi. You can trust me.
Well, let me tell you briefly how it went. This was a double match. That is, it was Dave and I against Dan and Wally, I believe.
No. Douglas.
All right, Douglas. Douglas, what was his last name?
Goldhammer.
Right after the wedding, was it, or before the wedding, or sometime around the wedding time?
I think we were already married, Judy, myself. Michael was trying to make an impression on me.
I was a very serious ping pong player, and it meant a lot to me to win.
He could barely see above the table.
David exploited that to his best, of course, because I was on his team. But the last, it was 19 to 20, they were winning.
No, but it was an overtime. We're up way up.
Maybe it was overtime. Yes, just step over that.
Hi, Elsie.
Step over the wire. Okay. Over the wire. Over the wire. Good one.
Here's my son.
Yeah. Overtime.
Are you sure?
David, wait a minute. What David does, which was very surprising and unorthodox, being a Reform rabbi, perhaps. I don't know why. He lobs the ball. Lobs the ball, 20-9, whatever, overtime. They're up by a point. You got to win by two. Lobs the ball. No. That's not the way it happened.
I didn't. He lobbed it. I went for the
slip. That's right. They lobbed it to David.
You know something? He's a lot younger than I am, and he's got Alzheimer's. Not quite Alzheimer's.
They lobbed the ball to David. That is, it was ready for a slam. It was a pretty easy slam. David was pretty good in those days.
Did he slam?
He slammed it and missed, and we lost the game.
Oh.
Tamar cut. How do you see that game, Dave?
Excuse me? What was the question?
Let's see. Hold the cut. Dave, how do you...
It should be 49 here.
How do you see that game, Dave?
What are we talking about? Do you mean when the Knicks used to lose the Celtics all the time?
No.
Which ones are we talking about?
The best out of seven ping pong match.
Well, here is Danny, and I must admit, I went down to...
Oh, a witness!
An ignominious defeat.
Hey, we got to clear the table for dessert.
That's right.
Hey! Oh, we're getting...
And as usual, Danny always blocks the way.
Excuse me.
Good one, Dan. All right, Dan, hold on. We have a surprise witness.
What kind of a witness?
Dan, here's a question, all right?
I'll call him at 5:30.
Best of seven series.
Yeah.
Take this stuff in.
Ping pong. It was approximately 1970 something. 70, okay? You were on.
Douglas won.
You and Douglas won. We both realize that.
We know that, Michael. And I
beat you. Were you? Who was favored to win that game?
First of all, I want to tell you something.
Obviously, you were favored.
Mike, Douglas, and I haven't revealed this now in close to.
Damn, move over a little.
Close to 26 years, and I. I'll reveal the truth now. Douglas and I bet on that game.
Oh.
And, I bet Douglas that he would win. And he bet himself that he'd win, too. And I dragged out as long as I could, and then I threw the match, and Douglas gave me about $23 to pay the tax on my boat ride to Israel, and that's what made me make Aliyah.
How do you feel about this? Tamara, do you believe your dad?
I find it hard to believe.
All right. Hard to believe.
By the way, there is an audio. Are you ready? You going?
Yeah.
There is an audio. Danny has just informed me. He of a large memory. He informed me that there's an audio tape of that game, the final game.
Who has that audio tape?
Mom and Dad have the tape.
And I understand.
You know about this tape, Dan?
I understand. Every night before they go to sleep, they play it.
This particular tape has been permanently stored in the FBI file for whatever future security reasons we may have to examine it.
Could it be in David's file?
Oh, he has a big portfolio with the FBI.
I do have a portfolio.
No, we're talking about your file, Dad.
My file on David? No, yeah. That has not grown ever since we first met.
All right, no thanks.
It's been declassified.
It has not been declassified. It destructed itself.
What? All right.
Hold it. Okay, Shifty is holding purple dessert plates, purple napkins, purple cups. There were also purple regular plates. This was in honor of Mum because of Mother's Day. She loves purple, so we catered this entire elegant meal in purple. The only exception is Ruthie. It's Shippy, who's wearing blue, but she does have purple right there, if you notice, right on her heart. That's what we call a purple heart.
And David, you have purple your heart.
I have a purple.
On your heart.
I have purple, too.
You didn't get a purple.
And I did it on purpose. Purpleless.
Jerry, what's out, tea?
Okay, here we go.
A tea.
Come on, Jerry, Bear.
Yeah, you have the opinion that, you know, the pre-67 Israel is a better, more moral kind of place, and whereas the post-67 Israelis were corrupted.
I think there's been a tremendous change in the morale and in the values of the country.
in 19...
For the worse
in some respects. In 1954, people could not imagine that theft or acts of violence of Jews against Jews were possible. It was very rare. For example, even in 1963, we still did not lock our cars. We felt that I had bought a car, but I always left it unlocked, and nobody ever stole anything, and it didn't occur to me that this would change. In 1954, the country was completely different. There was much more egalitarian poverty. There were very few rich people. Everybody was working hard. Many people were poor, and there were still considerable cases of actual hunger.
Well, does that mean that it wasn't necessarily out of choice? I mean, you have no choice to be poor, so you're going to be poor.
It was the tenor of the post-war of liberation.
It was the what?
Theory, the tenor.
What language is that?
Tenor is Hebrew. It meant deprivation. 54, I went to see Uncle Ari, Mom and I, and we saw them in their apartment. Arya and his wife Paula and their two sons, Dan and Gideon. And the greatest thrill that we could give them was to take them out for dinner to the Dan Hotel. They thought that it was absolutely marvelous. And we also brought them as gifts a food package from the United States.
And
in 1954.
Wait, now that was your first trip to Israel?
That was our first trip to Israel.
Uh-huh. Your first, too. I mean,
yeah. We stayed about 4 or 5 weeks, and we toured the whole country.
Just
and
the two of you?
Mom and I, and it was a really tremendous experience. It was wonderful. It was a different country, very different.
Uh-huh.
And then afterwards, we came back to Israel almost every year.
Uh-huh.
And in 63, 64, we stayed for a sabbatical, an entire year, with
right.
our four growing children.
Right.
Dana, I can't believe it's raining. It's raining. This is ridiculous.
Daniel's
got his crown.
But we don't have anyone that old. But it's 212, which is, it sums up all the ages of all the birthday people, and the average age is 42 and a half.
Hey.
You guys bring it up even. And we also found out that in Gematria, we have a few things that it can stand for. It could be Liv, which is argument, but since that's not a problem here, it can also be Rabbi. There are two Rabbis here having their birthdays.
There's only one who's a real one, the reform one.
Or it could be Beal without the hay.
What?
Beer. They like beer. They like beer. That's also good.
And we hope that they're very bleem.
Without the olive?
Bleem.
Without the olive?
So, Mazato.
Oh, no, and there's something else. You said that they are very happy.
Oh, very.
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 Oh. Okay, now, before we go on, just take...
Happy birthday.
Oh, thank you.
Where's Ruthie?
Also Mother's Day.
Oh, my goodness. And I forgot Rochelle's gift. She had one for you guys.
All right.
All right. We, the undersigned, Deborah M. Perlmutter, Dem H. Perlmutter.
Did you bring up
Judith H.
Foreman,
Daniel A. Hibby signed it. Michael A. Haberman, Mayor I. As well as Asma B. Haberman, David J. Foreman, Martha Kruger. Consider ourselves extremely lucky to have you as our mom. Happy Mother's Day. Oh,
thank congratulations.
You. Oh, that's very sweet. Now, I'll come around and kiss you individually.
No, not right now, no.
First, we have to eat the cake.
Well, God bless you. Speaking of God and speaking of blessing,
I have a lot to fill
you. That was Martha who got the blessing. We have a man of God who we're very blessed to have in our midst, who despite the fact that he has these divine
aspects to his personality.
Jerry?
He also has a lighter side, more humor. Now, indeed, he will expound that humor. Look at him.
Well, that story, that story that I want to tell you is nothing humorous. It was semi-tragic.
Okay, then we don't have to hear it. Next.
These are the funny, perhaps the top 10 funniest events in your life.
Well, it started out, I think, with our first meal after our wedding in our home in Spring Hill, Alabama, and Mom is going to tell you what happened.
It wasn't really our first meal. It was in our first little house there, and I wanted to prepare a very special dessert for...
Mom, you're not on stage. This is an informal conversation.
Well, you see, I made a banana cream pie, and I hid it from him. And when it came time to bring it out, I said, hide your eyes. And I went in the kitchen to get it, and I dropped it on the floor.
That's what I heard.
And it crashed. The Pyrex plate broke in 1,000 pieces, and we couldn't even taste the cake. And so what did I do?
She cried.
Mom cried. I have to add one thing. Like... mother, like daughter.
Now
Judy.
All right, now Judy.
Judy Foreman.
For some unknown reason, I decided I would make stuffed peppers. Except we didn't have any casserole dishes right after we married. So I did it in a pot. And then I put the pot in the oven. And then I went to take it out with my hands.
Oh.
And I burned myself and the whole thing spilled all over the place.
And in those days, when she said she had a pot in the oven, I thought this was going to be quite a meal.
All right.
Tell you about Debbie. A funny incident with Debbie occurred when she was about a year and a half old. She was not yet toilet trained, but she was beginning to be properly reared as a lady. And so one day I watched her. She was sort of twisting and turning and said, Debbie, you have to go to the toilet? And she said, no, no. And then she said, go down, Daddy.
Mind about your daughter, Judith?
Judith?
How about when she, like, knocked her... Did she have an accident?
What's really funny, on the day she was to have her class picture taken in about the third grade, she bumped into a tree. And so she had a petsa this big red right here on her forehead.
No, I had all over my nose.
All over
and her nose.
And Dad.
And she took the picture.
And Dad made her feel very good. He was very sympathetic and understanding. He said,
How could you
walk into a tree? I mean, how's that possible?
All right. Judy, do you have any comments? How did it feel, Jude?
There's an explanation, of course.
Oh, yeah, right.
I was standing
in those days, trees move.
I was standing in front of a tree, and Dottie, or somebody, was behind me. And I was talking to somebody else. And then I turned around and busted it right away, because it was right there.
Sure, okay.
So we have to tell you about Dottie. One day we came home. The two little girls were... with Dottie.
Who was Dottie? Not everybody knows Dottie.
Dottie was our maid.
Our maid. And we could not find Dottie nor the girls. We looked around. We were getting worried. What happened? We had left them with her. Finally, we hear a sound out of the downstairs bathroom in which they had locked themselves in. And
she locked them in.
She locked them in, and we asked her, what happened, Dottie? She said, there are bats flying. There were more than one. There are bats flying around in this house, and we're scared.
Was there more than one?
So there was more than one. And, Mom immediately appointed me as the hunter. I had to get a broom and chase the bats all over the place until finally I couldn't see them anymore.
They're gone.
So what happened? That night, neither Mom nor I could sleep because the two girls rushed into our beds and would not leave our beds until the morning.
No, because they saw the bat.
Is that true, Jude?
They saw the bat and you jumped almost from your bedroom right into their room. Mom was out of town.
I pictured you jumping down an entire...
All right.
Was out of town.
Wait a minute.
Debbie and
Mom was out of town and you two girls slept with your father.
Well, whatever happened to Debbie?
All right.
Were Debbie and Michael there? It used to be called Dr. Herzl Zion, but it was the Trenton Hebrew Academy. But sometimes, you know, you fall by the wayside, and one day he was playing over at the neighbor's, the Chilton's. I think it was a little toy of some sort. You remember what it was? No.
This must have been about Michael.
No, it was Danny. And he comes home with this very guiltily
And I said, what is that? She said, oh, it's just something they gave me. I said, are you sure they gave it to you? Yeah, well, they loaned it to me. So we took it back to the children, and sure enough.
Wait, now the children.
Wait a minute, sorry. Red cross plastic ring. Oh, I like it, but I want to steal it, and Tanina bit me. And since then, I learned my lesson.
Well, I have a story about Michael. Michael showed an early talent for business. Certainly, he wanted to make money. He went to Herzl Zion Hebrew School, I think in the first grade.
And he bribed the teacher for a good grade. That was his business.
And he learned there painfully that whenever he forgot his yarmulke, which was almost every day, he had to pay a dime for a new yarmulke. And that went on for a number of weeks.
Borrow it.
Until we finally collected who knows how many yarmulkes at home that he had bought. And one day an idea occurred to him. He would take all the yarmulkes to the school, and any boy who had forgotten his yarmulke would have to buy for a dime. So he would sell it or rent it for a
nickel.
And that's how Michael made his first money.
Right.
Well, I haven't had a better idea
since.
So
he was in the yarmulke business.
Right.
All right. What about the glass door story? How about that?
Oh, that was on the way home from our sabbatical year in Israel. We stopped in Paris, and we stayed in a little hotel near Notre Dame. Only all the doors were glass, and the girls and the boys didn't see the glass door.
We warned them.
One by one, they bumped into the door.
I was standing down there, I was tearing my hair out. Every one of them who came out bumped into the glass door and screamed bloody murder. One after the other of our four children.
And this may be the explanation as to why the house at Fenway Drive has these queer little flower decals all over the glass door.
So you'll see the glass
door. You shouldn't bump into the glass doors.
Oh, there was another story in Paris, that same visit. We took Debbie to a department store, Lafayette something, forgot the name of it. And there was a large model with clothes on, a mannequin. And Debbie was skipping around with Judy there, and suddenly we hear this scream. Debbie, what happened? What happened? She said, a splinter got into my toe, a splinter. And she wouldn't stop screaming. We tried and we tried to get it out. Nothing helped. So we said, you must have a doctor or a nurse or first aid around. Please tell us. So they said, yes, come up to the eighth floor and you can see her. So they took Debbie up. Meanwhile, she's crying and in pain, and they examined it very carefully. And they said, I'm sorry, there is nothing inside her toe. There is nothing. Well, Debbie, you have nothing in it. She said, but it hurts, it hurts. And it kept on hurting until, I would say, a couple of weeks after we got home. When suddenly, in her bathtub, a wooden splinter floated out of her toe. There it was. There was the mister. Amen.
That story, along with the bad story, made sense.
Found evidence of a deed which you did when you were about under a year old. You were still in the playpen in Trenton. And Debbie had a pet turtle, which we brought from Herring Pond. A little tiny turtle, and we called him Henry Herring from Herring Pond. And she loved that turtle. She fed him, and she walked him, and she played with him.
She walked him?
Yes. Yeah. She walked with him, let him walk outside. And then, one day...
She took a pooper scooper with her.
The turtle...
It took a very long time for the turtle to walk. 2 hours.
Yeah, that's why Debbie eats so slowly, by the way.
I never get to finish the story.
You finish your paper.
Too many interruptions. Anyway, the turtle was kept in this round plastic dish, and it had a little fake palm tree, I'll never forget. And then she'd feed the turtle every day, and it was on this coffee table next to Michael's playpen.
Enter Michael.
And
da,
then
da, 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 da,
Michael,
da, da.
In his innocence, reached out.
Oh, wait.
Not innocence, but malice.
Oh, okay, I was just looking.
In his malice. Evil, wicked nature, human nature.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Michael grabbed and pulled the turtle, and he didn't know. He thought it was a toy, I suppose, and he pulled it apart.
Oh, disgusting. No, he thought he put a pencil in it.
No, he pulled
it apart.
He
speared it with a pencil, and then He dissected it in the biology lab.
And then Debbie came home.
Debbie came home and cried eyes out.
Disgusting. Ew.
All right, fine.
Reaction. All right. Talk.
After Debbie, after Debbie had cried eyes out and sort of halfway got
over this, she called.
Now wait a second. She got an assignment in her class to write a little essay, and she wrote an essay and handed it in entitled "My Brother the Murderer."
And she won a prize too.
She won a prize.
And
essay.
Michael was arrested, by the way.
That was
my brother the murderer.
What a well-trained child. She brought out her toothbrush.
Okay.
What else?
Well, our first day in Jerusalem during our sabbatical was a disaster. I think we have to tell that story. We had just unpacked in our new apartment.
What year?
In the
63.
Year 1963 on
August.
Where was
Carlop. Slosh invitation.
And there were all these suitcases. We had also a big trunk, you know, one of those camp trunks that we had opened. And
it was Tisha B'Av.
Well, it was Tisha B'Av.
You know what the greeting is for Tisha B'Av? Good grief.
Good grief. So we had just unpacked. We were ready to relax when Michael started jumping around, and sure enough, he fell and he gashed his knee
on the metal corner
of the trunk, and there was blood gushing out, and he was screaming bloody murder. And here we were for the first day in Jerusalem, and there was no way in which we could deal with this, so we had to take him to Hadassah Hospital. I had no idea how to get there, but somehow instinct brought me over to this neighborhood. We get to Hadassah Hospital.
You put a down payment on the house on the way there.
But by this time, remember, hours had passed. We hadn't eaten the meal. And Michael Michael gets to the hospital. And what he wants most of all is to eat or drink something. And the doctors and the nurses shook their heads and said, no, it's Tisha B'Av, no food, no drink.
No cafeteria.
Well, you haven't heard the end of it. Michael screamed all through for hours, not over the gash in his knee, but over the fact that he was hungry, empty stomach. See, so in some way or other, Michael was a very observant young boy.
Thanks, sir.
The moral of the story is
there's another one about Michael.
Michael still cries if he can't feel his stomach.
There's another one about Danny, too.
Better tell the one about Danny now.
Well, we'll continue with Danny. Papa Haberman came for a visit. Papa Haberman came for a visit during that sabbatical. And so we took him up on a trip to the Galilee, and we left the children, the younger children, all of them, right? With Ahuva, our Ozeret. She stayed with them about 3 or 4 days while we were gone. And what happened? Daniel was playing out in the street. Someone had put an old water heater outside to give away. Water heater, which there was a sharp metal edge, and it ripped open his tush.
His rear end.
They know what tush.
His tush? Yeah. What?
Blood was gushing out, so Debbie took him upstairs immediately to the maid, Ahuva, and she fainted.
The maid fainted.
So no, Debbie.
She just made exactly like Ellie in the movie.
She went, So Debbie, getting her wits together, looked up the phone number for Dr. Cher, who lived down the block, and she called him up and she said, I need help. My brother is hurt.
She was like 15.
So she brought, they got in a taxi, they called a taxi, and Ahuva was in the car. And Debbie had Michael and Judy.
I don't remember this at all, by the way.
In the cabin, they went to Dr. Cher's office, and he stitched him up, and they went home.
He stitched his tushy.
You have a scar there?
That must have been very painful when you went to the bathroom.
Dan, could you just turn around for a minute?
It's just a tushy.
Never mind.
So ever since then, Danny is
full of stitches.
All right.
Didn't Michael also get walk into a car?
No, Michael was in my car and saying, what a great sabbatical.
Well, among Ahuva, the stories about Ahuva go on, but there's just one thing I want to tell. When Michael at that time was very young, And we were all busily learning Hebrew in the Old Testament in school and so on, but he didn't go to school yet, so his Hebrew...
He's in God.
He went to
well, but his Hebrew wasn't very sophisticated.
What do you mean? He still spoke well.
So when Ahuva started talking Hebrew to him, he didn't want to answer. He didn't understand. So what he would do is, he was playing with his trucks and his toys. He'd say, Ahuva, I'm waking. And Ahuva would, when we came back, he said, what does this
Maza,
mean?
Maza,
I'm waking. But then something happened. Michael was a bit on the rash side, and he would run around on the streets, and he ran across Kalab directly into the path of a car. And
hey, real,
he was run,
real funny.
He was hit pretty hard. The driver was considerate enough and scared. He fainted or what, took him in his car and took him to a hospital.
Without telling
anybody. We come home.
No.
And you were so annoyed when they told, when they
then
knew
a neighbor, where he was. A neighbor saw it and she said, Michael was hit by a car and your neighbor took him to a hospital. We said, which hospital? She said, I don't know.
So here we are. We have no idea how badly he was hit, by who he was hit, where he was. Well, to make the story short, we checked with all of the hospitals, visited us, until finally we found
Shaare Tzedek,
and Michael was smiling there. He wasn't in a very bad shape. He had a slight concussion.
It wasn't Tisha B'Av.
They fed him. Everything was okay.
Zero. Now let's.
Good boy. In the same house, we were on the third floor, and the neighborhood boy may have been on the fourth floor. In
Adi Shvaid,
very well-known, prestigious family related to Eliezer Shvaid, the professor. So Danny and this boy one day got up to the roof where the landlady had sacks of flax. I mean,
seeds.
And what did the boys do? One by one, they took one of those sacks, opened it or dug a hole in it, and
emptied
it was like
the
snow. The
garden.
Whole garden was covered with flats, the flowers, the bushes, the grass, like snow. And we come home, and the landlady was going to kill us. She said, what has your boy done? I said, our boy is in flats. Where is he? We finally find Danny confessing his misdeed of having plastered the whole garden.
Idea, right?
Danny was plastered.
All right, Dan.
We were plastered.
Take off your glasses.
We want to see if this is a real.
Take off the sunglasses, Dan.
Come on,
what
Danny.
Do you
want to
know, Mike? Danny, take off the sunglasses.
Take off those
Come on,
glasses.
Danny, you look like Amadio Yosef.
He's
like the same little boy. All right, never mind.
I see that evil glint in his eyes.
Can you give us that glint?
All right. Okay, but I have a story about Ruthie.
All right, wait a minute.
Ruthie?
Yeah.
No,
Ruthie.
This Ruthie? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're not quite up to Ruthie yet, but...
No.
All right. All right,
well,
fine.
We won't tell you about the mystique of Ossie. We'll just talk about Ruthie.
All right, well, whatever you want to do.
Well, let somebody else
Let somebody else.
No. Here's... Unless... All right. How about, let's go to both of you guys. I mean, what happened, what did Mom do with that famous speech of yours, Dad?
Well, we were on our way to the Shoham Hotel, and I was to introduce Leah Rabin and make some kind of an address about the Israel bond drive.
What year?
And that was in the year 1969. I had just come to Washington. It was my first public appearance, and I was very eager to turn our congregation toward a pro-Israel Zionist posture. So I prepared carefully. It was a speech that I had made. And on our way down to the Shoham Hotel, we stopped at the little mailbox. I said, Maxine, please take these letters and put them in the mailbox. So she picks up a bunch of letters, including a large manila envelope in which there was my speech. And before I could even say, please don't. He dropped my speech into the mailbox.
And I said...
And I
fear not. If you wrote it once, you can do it again.
I had only 3 minutes to get to the shore. I said, Maxine, you take the wheel now, and I'll see...
Wait a minute. How did you really say, Maxine, you take the wheel?
Well,
how did you say it? No, what was the tone of your voice?
He was very calm. He said, okay, you take the wheel. Let's just not talk. I'll try.
Ever? No. He said, let's not talk ever again.
And as quickly as I could, I reconstructed my own mind what I was going to say.
And he was wonderful.
Yes, I had a gigantic headache at the end of that banquet.
But the end story is that it came back to us in the mail.
About a year and a half later.
Really? How?
Yeah.
Somebody opened it up and read it?
No, it was in the post. Yes, somebody. It was finally
in an envelope.
In an envelope, you know, finally. Postmaster so read it, he saw the name Rabbi Haberman.
And it had a check for $100,000 made out of Israel bonds. It was unbelievable.
So they finally located us a year and a half later. The speech
it's
came
be
back.
Boring.
Ruthie.
This
Ruthie, Ruth not Ruthie Lambert.
Rabbi Haberman.
Come on, Ruthie.
The camera in the eye, but the other way, it looks terrible.
Okay.
And they were playing in the sand.
Can you open the door?
This and that. Suddenly we said, Ruthie said, look what I found. Masa Masati. Kisses. So we figured, well, she has money for, you know, some more mastik or something.
How does she know how to
laugh? Now, Akshav, Yeshli, Kisses, Bishvil, Tzedakah.
Oh,
that was very nice.
But there's a follow-up because, you know, Ruthie isn't all... Yes. Because then we brought her a few things, a little gift next time we came, and we said, Ruthie, we have a few little gifts for you. And she looked at them, and they were little, and she said, I also like bigger gifts.
All right.
Louder.
Well, can we speak right. English again?
No, I can't think of anything right now.
What's the story?
I got a good one about it, too.
She walked in her sleep.
I woke up in the morning. I hear something downstairs. He says, I'll go. I said, no, wait, I'll go with you. So we go down the stairs. Sure enough, we hear the stairs. We go down, and here we see Judy. Walking, like
listen, you know something? And she's kept it up. After we were married, Judy went to concert at a camp, and she had a little kid named Loretta in her bunk. And so
before we were married, I was a counselor.
She was a counselor. We got married. So all of a sudden, in the middle of the night, Judy gets up and says, Loretta, you stay away from here. Don't come near here. I said, Judy, you're dreaming. Loretta's not. He said, David, I know I'm dreaming. Loretta, you get away from here. I said, Judy. She said, Judy, you understand what's going on? I said, David, the court. Loretta, I told you. Of course, then Judy got up once. We're in Cincinnati. We're in Cincinnati. Judy gets up, gets fully dressed, she's ready to leave. She says, David, I'm going to school. Why is it so dark out? Judy, it's 3 o'clock in the morning.
I was an eager student.
I never heard that.
All right, anything else there?
Martha, we never heard. We only know that you are very, very
naughty
girl. Mischievous girl.
Only her mother.
The focus on Danny. He's the focus.
Wait a minute. Judy called us. You better get ready for
the game. Wait a minute. Yeah. Tell the story again. Wait a minute.
Danny met this young woman in Israel.
Bonnie. Was her name was Bonnie?
Danny was searching.
It was Bonnie.
Danny was hot to trot. He wanted to get married, right? He wanted to find somebody. He meets this American woman studying in some yeshiva or something.
I don't know what she was
studying. In some program. She was there for the year or something. And he liked her. We didn't meet her, but he went out with her. I don't know, it was maybe a month or two, or I don't know.
And she was a real hardcore settler. And she wanted to take Danny out to Shiloh or somewhere to visit. And I said, Danny, I don't know how safe it is, you know. This is even before the Intifada.
Right.
And Danny said, well, she does carry a gun. He noticed it when he went shopping with her. For
he saw on her shopping list.
Saw on her shopping list, bullets. So Danny said,
true?
A little suspicious there, you know, bullets.
Yeah. Later on, Danny.
realized yeah. this was not the woman.
So Danny decided to break up with her. So Danny said, Dave, I don't think this is the right woman for me. So I think I should, how do I break up with her? I said,
very carefully. Good one.
That's a good one.
I'm a doctor. I'm getting my teeth set. But all I know is that Danny did not get engaged with me until he learned that I could cook.
Oh, that's a good one.
No, he found out that I could cook. One time he came to visit me. Once he came to visit me at my parents' house, and for some reason or other we couldn't go out, and we were hungry, so I went into the kitchen and I prepared some latkes. And he liked the latkes, and shortly afterwards we...
Whoa, what? You what?
We got engaged.
Oh. Very good.
I think he's got more. I was dating by then. I had gone out with all the eligible young men in Jerusalem by then. And I was just tired of dating.
And so you settled?
So Danny comes over to the house at Motzei Shabbat, and there's a Shlomo Carlebach concert on television. So I figured, another boring evening, I might as well leave the television on. So I left the television on, and there we have Shlomo Carlebach singing in the background. And every few minutes, I would turn around and say, look, there's something interesting for you. And in the meantime, Danny was talking about, we were talking about words. And the only reason why we ever got together again is because we had bet about a word, how to spell it, and we had to check it out, and we met again, and again, and again, and that is not the end of the story, but the beginning of the story.
Okay, pal.
Yeah, but I drive
along. Both Michael and Danny, that was in Trenton, in our synagogue there, when Mom took both boys to services. Danny was on one side of Mom, and Michael was on the other. Michael, at that time, was dressed in a little sailor suit with a naval whistle in his pocket. And during services, Mom tried to caution the boys to be nice and quiet, and so she whispered to Danny to be nice and quiet. And she said it a second time. All of a sudden, Danny yelled out, stop, stop. Whispering in my ear. And so everybody around it heard it. Of course, people turned around. A little while later, Michael figured he had to do something. So
wait.
Took out his whistle from his Navy suit and kept looking at Mom, put the whistle to his mouth, and Mom was petrified that he would blow the whistle.
But he didn't.
But a good boy he was this time. He just tortured her,
right.
And he put the whistle right back into his pocket. I think it was the last
time
that Mom let him wear his Navy suit.